I want to read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2. And I want to read from verse 8. Luke 2, verse 8 says, "Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were greatly afraid. And then the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people.'" Verse 11. "For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Glory to his name tonight. You know, I thank God tonight for what he's doing. I thank God tonight that he's changing men and women's lives. I thank God tonight for the testimonies that we've heard of what God can do, the power of God, and what he's doing in men and women's lives. But our Lord Jesus Christ, and I know we know this tonight, I'm speaking to all people, young Christian, old Christian, non-Christian, backslidden Christian, I'm appealing to all people, because in that chapter it makes reference to all people. The sole aim of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to the scriptures, was to seek and to save that which was lost. That's his sole purpose. And you know, here in this particular time, amen, we find shepherds tending flock at night. Amen. And in this particular time, the people were looking for someone to rescue them. They were under Roman rule. They were looking for somebody to deliver them. They were looking for many reasons, but the reason. And I want to speak about the reason why Jesus Christ came. We have all different ideas of who Jesus is and what Jesus came to do. Jesus can deliver me from alcohol. Jesus can deliver me from drugs. Jesus can save my marriage. Jesus can make me happy. We have all these different ideas. And the people at this particular time, in the time I'm reading about, they had all their different ideas of this leader, that, you know, what they wanted him to do. And you know, an angel appears to these shepherds, and the words that he says to them is, "I bring you good news of great joy." Good tidings, good news. Amen. Good news of great joy. And it's good to hear good news. Amen. It's good to hear good news tonight. In a world where there is so much bad news, in a world where bad news dominates, you put on the television, you see so much bad news all around us. Amen. In different countries of war, peace can't seem to be found, never will be found. And so, the message that the angels brought, the message that the Word of God brings tonight, it's good news. It's a message of hope. It's a message of a future. It's a message of something that we can grasp, that we can take hold of, and we can access, and we can bring it into our life and say, you know what? I want this good news. I want this good news. I don't want to go home with bad news. I don't want to go home with bad news tonight. I want to go home with good news tonight. I'm not speaking of good news tonight that you're going to go home and you're going to be a granddad or a granny. That's nice. That's good news. But that's not the purpose. That's not the point. What did he say? "I bring you good news, good tidings of great joy, which will be for all people." Praise the Lord tonight. For all people. Gypsy, traveller, gorger, black, white. The message of the cross. The message of the cross tonight. God doesn't miss anybody out. He misses no one out. The For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. The message of the cross is for all people. Good news that these shepherds brought. They were bringing the news of the birth of the Messiah. I understand that. They were bringing good news that, you know, he's arrived. He's come. He's here. The book of Micah speaks and prophesies one day he will come in the town of Bethlehem. Good news. Not having a newborn. Not I'm going to put my makeup on and dress nice. I'm not speaking of that good news. Them things can happen if you're a Christian or not. I'm speaking of the good news Luke chapter 2 speaks about. Tonight, listen carefully, because Christian, you might get saved through the word of the message tonight. I know that I said Christian. I bring good news of tidings of great joy, which will be for all people. For there is born this day in the city of David a Savior, prophecy. Not only prophecy, but history. The scripture says that there is born this day, that day, Jesus Christ, over 2,000 years ago, was born into this world. Amen. He was born into this world for a purpose and for a reason. And I believe that. You believe that. Historically, I believe the word of God to be true. When I look around me, and I look at creation, I believe that there is a God. But nobody else could do the things which I see with my own eyes. I see the stars, I see the moon, I see the sun. I see the seasons come and go. Seasons, autumn, spring, winter. Man can't do that. So I see and I understand that there must be somebody greater than me. Man can put a man on the moon, but man can't make the moon. And it leads me to a place in my own life where I say there must be a God. There must be somebody greater than me. Man can make an iPhone, but he can't make the moon, he can't make the stars. There must be a God. There must be a God. In my own natural understanding, there must be a God. I bring you good news of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior. A Savior, amen. A Redeemer. Somebody who has come to pay the price, to buy back, to bring us back. Back from what? Well, according to the scripture. Listen tonight. Listen, Christian, so-called Christian for 30 years, but you still swear, tell lies, do the same rubbish. Listen what I'm saying. One day we'll close our eyes to this world and we'll open up to an eternal God. Listen to the word what I'm saying. If you don't come through this understanding, you will never be saved. If you come for any other reason, you will never be saved. Amen. We have to come to the point in our life where we realize that without God we are rotten, that we are sinful, that we failed him on every aspect in our life. Why do we need a Savior? We need a Savior because the scripture clearly teaches, for all has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everyone, whether you're decked in diamonds or whether you're living in the gutter, it makes no difference where God is concerned. We've all fell short of that standard. The Bible says very clearly that sin separates us from God. This is why we need a Savior tonight. Sin separates from God. What does that mean? It separates. What it means is that you can't be in the presence of God. Mankind in their sinful state cannot be in the presence of God. Because God is holy. God is holy and he can't live where sin is. He can't live there. Because that's his character, that's his nature. That's his very essence. He is holy. He doesn't try to be holy. It's who he is. I am sinful. That's who I am. God is holy and that's who he is. And so, we're at the farthest point. We're lost, bound for the fires of hell. The term is used Gehenna, the Bible. It's known as the lake of fire. The Bible says, the worm never dies, the fire never goes out. It speaks to me being a place of outer darkness. It speaks to me being a place where there's gates. It says that the devil, the Antichrist, the false prophet, they will all go there. A place that is prepared for the devil and his demons. Listen, Christian. Listen, all people. Why do we need a savior? We need a savior because of what I'm telling you. Why did he have to be born into this world? Good news, tidings, and joy. For him to die, he had to be born. We needed a savior because we are lost. We were lost in our sinful state. We have no way of saving ourselves. We have no way of saving ourselves. A doctor can't do it. Some big top physician can't do it. No matter how much we try to be good, it's never going to be good enough. No matter how many efforts and how many times we give to the poor, we can never give enough. The standard is so high. The moment we sinned for the first time, we fell below that standard and we were lost for eternity. But praise be to the Lord tonight. The Savior, he came. The Savior, he came. I bring you good tidings of great joy. Good news, amen. Good news. Which is for all people. It's for you tonight. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior. Praise the Lord. For God so loved the world. I want to tell you something tonight. I can never ever explain it enough. We can never explain enough the love of God for me and for you tonight. That he would send his one and only begotten Son. Because of this problem of sin, he would send his one and only begotten Son to die upon the cross. Amen. Beaten, mocked, spat at. Why did he do it? He did it tonight because he loved each and every one of you in this place. Each and every one. He loved each and every one of you tonight in this place. Amen. That's why he did it tonight. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Christ. Glory to God. Who is the Christ? That word, it means the anointed one. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say he is the one. He is the one we have to look to. He is the one we have to run to. He is the reason we go to church. He is the reason. No other reason. We don't come to show off our handbags. We don't come to show off our suits. We don't come to show off our cars. We come because we come for Jesus. We come because we believe he died for us. We come because we believe he rose from the dead for us. The grave couldn't hold him. The Bible says that. And 3 days later, the Father, he raised him from the dead. But the point is, he is the Christ tonight. He is the reason we go. He is the reason we come to the front and we say, Lord Jesus, forgive me. Lord, I'm sorry for the things I've done. Come into my life. Wash me clean. I want to be a child. Forgive me for the things I've done. We don't come to him. Understand what I'm trying to say. He does give us a better life. But we don't come to him for that. He does give us a better life. Of course he does. When you're a Christian, he gives you peace. You have somebody to pray to. When you're a Christian, you've got hope if you need healing because you know it's possible that he can do it. So we know the after effect. But the reason we come to him is because we recognize that I'm sinful. The reason we come forward in the meeting is not because we want my child to be healed. Oh, the reason we come to him is because God has revealed to us, he's shown us I'm a sinner. And he leads to a place and, you know, hell, we realize the realization of hell and how real this place is. And in our mind, it ain't me or the preacher, it's just you and him. You have this revelation, just you and him. And you realize, you know what? I don't want to take a chance on my soul. And so God leads you to a place where there is light. He leads you to a place where there is hope. He leads you to a place where there is glory. And that place tonight is found at the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Over 2,000 years ago, he died on that cross. And he shed his blood and he breathed his last. That me and you can come and say, forgive me, Father. Forgive me, Jesus. I'm sorry for what I've done. Wash me clean. We come to him because we want to go to heaven and we want to escape the fires of hell.